Welcome back to Live With, brought to you by Species Nutrition. Visit speciesnutrition.com. I'm Dave Palumbo, and today's guest is one of my favorite people in the industry. I consider him a very good friend. He is probably best known as Mr. Incredible. Of course, the man I'm talking about is Andy Haman. Welcome back to the show. It's been a while.
It has been a while, but I'm glad to be here, and you know, you always bring a smile to my face there.
So. I'm going to start out the show with a controversial question. Andy, have you really, because, you know, everything on YouTube now is people lifting with fake weights and everything like that. So people always ask me, did Andy Haman really bench press 600 pounds, you know, with no equipment on?
The answer to that question is no, I benched 675 pounds.
Wow.
Which was about 15 minutes after I did 600 pounds with a tank top on.
Yeah.
And when I did it, it was when you could not get on your phone and just post.
Right.
I had to hire a guy for $300 to videotape me and then post it on YouTube because we couldn't do it.
Sure.
But you can ask anybody at my gym whether they hate me or love me, and they'll say, yeah, that guy, I don't want to see that guy, or I love that guy, or because he is strong. And I'm still really strong. I'm just strong in my mind right now, not so much in my body.
Well, I remember you did that a couple years ago. You had built that 300-pound dumbbell and used to do overhead dumbbell extensions for triceps. And didn't you tore your tricep doing that, right?
Yeah, it was really nice. It was it sounded like a gunshot when my tricep actually snapped from my bone. My son Sam, luckily Sam's stronger than I am, and he actually spotted me.
Oh, good.
And I did 200 pounds for 15, so we went ahead and made this 300-pound dumbbell, and I'm doing pretty good. And then it just went, bah! It just popped like that, and it was all over. Sam took me to the emergency room. He got me a bottle of Gatorade, and I spent the rest of the day in surgery.
The funny thing about that was a lot of people didn't realize you had some contractual obligations, and you didn't want the company you were working for to know what would happen, so you kept it very hush-hush. And I know, didn't you go to Japan right after you get that done?
We did. In fact, I had about half a dozen expos that I went to, and I actually did some wrestling with that too, and did some technique shows in China.
Wow.
Both in China and in South America, and got through those as well, which, you know, it was insane, but, you know, that's just part of it. And at that time I still was, you know, going pretty strong. So, you know, the one thing that we've always done is I've always had a lot of fun, and even going through that, I kind of bounced back from that tricep injury. And within a year, I was benching 500 pounds again, 550 pounds again, when I turned 50.
Why do you think you're so strong? I mean, because that's like, you know, crazy strength. That's not like because I'm strong because I work out. That's I'm strong because I was born this way strong.
Oh, definitely. Just like you were strong, or you have, you know, you and I were born with a gift, just like.
The gift, you know, of gab. That's what we have. Yeah.
What's that?
We have the gift of gab.
Well, we do. But you know, I always talk to young people and young men and women. Even older people will come to me and talk to me about different things. And you know, we're all born with those types of gifts. And I was always strong. It didn't matter what I was doing when I was a little baby. You know, when I was a toddler, I was strong. When I was in elementary, I was running faster than anybody else. I was climbing on the roof. When I was in junior high, you know, I was wrestling with the wrestling coach. When I was in high school, I was wrestling with college guys. Mm-hmm. And I just was always strong. The very first time that I ever lifted weights was when I was a freshman in high school. We didn't even have a weight room. But my high school brought me up to try out for the football team, which I made the varsity team, and they had a universal weight machine, and it was a four station. I don't know if you remember
that. I remember. We had it nothing. Everyone wanted to bench press the rack, right?
Go ahead. I bench pressed the rack.
No
I,
way. First time?
First time. First time. I just kept doing it. I overhead pressed the shoulder press.
Oh,
we had a lat pull down, which I did the stack, and then we had a leg press, which I did the stack too. And I was like, what should I do?
But Andy, no one else did that. You were the only one doing that, and you never had even lifted, right?
Yeah, but if you go on my Instagram, Andy Haman Instagram, you'll see a picture of me when I was 11 years old in 1976, and I have really bigger legs and biceps and chest and better abs than, you know, probably a 20-year-old at that time.
That's crazy. Did you work out or no?
No, I just ran and rode my bike, and I was born that way. Just like you were born with your physique, and it's easier to build. But then we all get into these contests as we get older, whether it's football, baseball, or whether you're academics or singing or bodybuilding. And then we get pushed into this, you know, kind of, you know, 25 of the best in the world. And then then you really see who's really gifted. And you really see guys like Jay Cutler and you know, of course, Arnold and Tom Platz and Phil Heath and you know, guys like Arash and Robert Timms and those kind of guys. And then all of a sudden you're not quite what you thought you were. But up until then, you know, you're a fantastic athlete, or you're really strong. You know, guys like Stan Efferding are the real deal. And, you know, guys, my son's, you know, was born with great genetics. He got way better genetics than I did. He got my wife's genetics and a little bit of my genetics and my father's genetics. And so he's going to advance even better if he chooses to.
Right. I love that picture that you have up on your Instagram of your wife and you in 1976. People don't realize, like, you knew your wife. You guys were little kids. It's a great picture.
Yeah, we've been together for over 36 years, which most people watching today or listening aren't even probably 26 years.
Yeah. That's crazy. How old were you in that picture with her in 76?
I'm 11 years old.
Wow. That's crazy. Crazy that you know each other that long.
I have a Speedo on, but I still wear my Speedo.
You still have the same one, too.
What
people don't realize is that, you know, you got into the bodybuilding really early in your teenage years, but then you kind of stopped. You know, we discussed this, and you stopped because, you said to yourself, well, I'm not good enough, right? And didn't you take, what, like 15 years off in between competing as a team?
I took 18 years off. And it really was because Michelle and I had decided to go ahead and have a family. Right. And we moved to Colorado Springs, which we've been here now 27 years. Mm-hmm. In fact, we're having a blizzard right now.
Which is pretty insane, because we said it was 80 degrees there yesterday, right?
It was 79 degrees yesterday. And it hasn't hit us quite yet, but we're going to have, believe it or not, 50 to 60 mile an hour winds here.
Oh, wow.
We closed down everything, all the athletic events. My daughter's playing tennis right now. And Michelle's closing down her office. It's just a great place to be.
But tomorrow everything will be cleared. You guys are like ready for snow there. They had to get rid of snow. And if it ever snowed in Florida, the whole state would shut down for the next 6 weeks probably, you know.
Yeah. We know how to shovel here.
Yeah, so. That's true. So you took 18 years off to have a family, and then you decided, hey, I didn't do what I wanted to do, and you got back to bodybuilding. And I know that's when you kind of contacted me, or right after that. And, you know, we started working together. We've told the story before. You won the Masters Nationals. And then you created the Mr. Incredible Andy Haman character, and you went on to, you know, do a lot of great stuff and make money and go all over the world and really influence a lot of people, visit kids' hospitals and do all kinds of fun stuff. You know, when you got into the game or got back into the game and you were kind of, you know, in your late 30s at that point, What was the game plan? Like, in your mind, what were you saying, hey, what do I want to do with this?
Well, I think the most important thing was that I was going to, if I got back into bodybuilding, I was going to have a fun, or number one, fun. My dog here is getting dog treats. Hold on. Let me give him.
She's having a lot of fun. Yeah.
Yeah. Was if I was going to get back into bodybuilding, I was going to actually have fun. And you got to remember, this was before social media. And at bodybuilding events, at physique events, at powerlifting, at strongman, and it wasn't even really strongman following yet.
Yeah.
But it was a different atmosphere. There wasn't this, you know, everybody is having fun and everybody's equal. You know, that atmosphere, you know, was tough. And so I had some experiences with some bodybuilders that weren't particularly, you know, that positive, that nice, that open, that caring. And so I wanted to be that type of bodybuilder. And so that was our main thing. I told Michelle, you know, if I get back into this, I want to be the nicest bodybuilder in the world. Mm-hmm. And after I got a hold of you, and you finally decided to help me, which, you know, you were probably one of my, you were really one of my heroes in bodybuilding. You were one of my favorite people. You had a great physique. You had a huge physique. And so that's kind of how I wanted to be. And then when we finally got together, you know, we found some success.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't 100% success, but it was pretty quick. And so when I got back into it, I just started hugging and kissing and being, you know, a coach, a father, a grandfather to whoever I saw. And that really catapulted me into the expo world, specifically with Diamond Ties. I worked with Diamond.
I think the snowstorm might have gotten the better of Andy Haman. We lost him there for a minute. Let's see if we can get him back. I'll tell you. Let's see. I think we got him back.
We get you back.
Yeah, we got you back, Andy.
Yeah, and so that was my main purpose. I knew that at age 40, I won the Masters. At age, you know, 41, I was already, you know, I had 3, 4, 5 different booths at different expos, and, you know, really ran with that for about 7 or 8 years, and, you know, would have 200, 300, 400 people in line waiting for me just to take a picture and have fun. And this wasn't with really even a phone. Most of it was a photo or a photograph or something we would give to them.
And you always had a costume on too. You always had some kind of a shtick going on in whatever booth you had, for whatever it was, whether it be the old time strongman look, or you had the Mr. Incredible costume on, or you were spray tan something, some other superhero. You always had some kind of a theme to what you did, which I liked. I love, because there's a story behind everything you did, and it made people want to go over and see what you were doing. And I thought, hey, this guy gets it. It's about creativity. It's about getting people excited and interested. It's about bringing the kids there and coming, you know, enabling the average person to relate to you, rather than you look like this big monster bodybuilding sitting behind this booth that was so unapproachable that no one was even wanting to go up and say hello to you. And I think that you changed the way people kind of approach the expos because of that.
Well, thank you. I tell you, that certainly, I think that me and you spoke about that a little bit, and I know that your enthusiasm for that rubbed off as well. I kind of came into it just that, you know, no matter if I went to a grocery store, I was at one of my kids' athletic events, whether I was working out, whether I was traveling, you know, people would shy away. And so if I smile, I would make myself smile.
Yeah.
I would, if I wasn't in a good mood, I pretended to be in a good mood. So I acted like that. And I tell people that as well. I tell young men and young women, you know, there's no job that we all love that doesn't have its problems or stresses. And it's the same thing here. You gotta act. You gotta be a good actor. Mm-hmm. For the most part, you know, I love doing what I do, what I did. And we just decided that we were going to bring in something fun. And the incredible thing was really easy. I had a bunch of little kids. We decided to kind of spray paint ourselves. One day I was acting like a strong man. We decided to add a mustache and grease my hair back. I did the Incredible Hulk. We did some other things, you know, Captain America, and I did, you know, Captain Andy and Mr. Diamond Hines and so on and so forth. But it was like you said, it was just about having fun. And most people that go to those expos, you know, are going to either go to the show, but they're bringing their wife, their husband, their mother, their father, their kids.
Right.
And so, you know, 75% of the people at Expo really don't even, you know, give a hoot about the bodybuilders. So I knew that I would snag those people because they go, oh my God, who's this guy? You know, look at he's silly or he's having fun or, you know, he's, yeah. you know, it was easier. It was less intimidating and, you know, it was more fun for me. And I got more people in line, so.
And then of course, you got your son involved, too, with a lot of the acts. You know, we did a couple bros versus pros. He was there with you, and we had a lot of fun doing those back in the day. Now, here's a question I wanted to ask you. Since I'm a new father, and my kids are, you know, just still young, but pretty soon they're going to be getting into sports and stuff like that, like yours were. You know, I'm obviously not big anymore like I was in the past, but when you were going to your kids' sporting events, you were a big guy. I mean, and you know, people might not know this, but, you know, you were a Division I wrestler. You wrestled for Dan Gable over in Iowa. I mean, you were the real deal. I mean, did you ever get into arguments with parents or anyone ever try to start with you at all?
You know, for the most part, no.
You look pretty intimidating, but, you know, you act like a goofball. So I figured maybe some of these guys would take you as like a pushover and try to like start trouble with you.
You're just trying to get me to, you know, give up a horrible story.
Yeah,
I know. And I'm not going to take the bait. However, when I was coaching, you know, one season, I actually, the Colorado High School Board of Athletics, I had to go up before the board because I was a little bit too boisterous at times. And so I had to go talk to them up in Denver. And they decided they were going to allow me to continue coaching. The only way they would allow me to continue coaching is if I had a seatbelt on. So I had the shot in high school actually put a seatbelt, adjustable seatbelt on my coaching chair. So when I got up, I would finally sit back down because, you know, wrestling is an individual sport. And it's funny because my daughter's in tennis now and it's an individual sport, but you can't say anything at tennis. You have to sit there and it's insane. And, you know, I grew up being a football and wrestling coach here in Colorado. And, so yeah, I mean, you know, there's certainly some times when, you know, the sport tests you or your kids are doing good and you want to yell and scream for them. And throughout my kids, sporting, history. I really just kind of stepped back and put myself in the coach's seat and said, hey, let those guys coach. I'm going to love and hug them when they get off the mat, when they get off the court, when they get off the field. And I don't let the coach yell at them. I'm not going to yell at them. Because I know when I was a coach, you know, I would hammer guys verbally. I would make them do things physically. They all knew that I loved them and supported them, but I would also talk to the parents about, you know, listen, let me do that. Uh-huh. You guys be a parent and be positive and support them. Because if you're not positive and support them, they don't have anybody. And so all the time when I was coaching, you know, I would always talk to parents about that and say, you know, let me be the bad guy. Let me be the heavy. And you guys come in and be the support system. Let me be the motivation, the negative, the positive motivation and drive them. Because we had parents that would come in and just rip their ass and treat them like shit and scream at them. And then that's when I had to take them off, those particular parents, and have a conference and say, gotcha. You can't do that. It's going to ruin them. And you know, it's a tough thing as kids grow up to be able to succeed and to please their parents, to please themselves, to please their coach, and to look good. And especially now with the whole social media thing, it's not an easy task.
Yeah. You know? Now you obviously have raised your children very successfully. What were some of the, I guess you could say, the hardships or the tough times that you had, you know, with the girls and with your son, that you could maybe impart wisdom-wise, not just to me, but to everyone else out there watching?
Well, I think that you have kids, and the first time, you know, you see them, it's an unbelievable experience, and you can attest to that. It's the best thing that's ever happened to your life. And so, you know, you have another one, and you have another one, and you have another one, like we did.
Yeah.
And we tried to have a couple more after, but having children really changes your life, and it changes your goals, and it changes you know, how really tough, you know, you are. And I've always kind of been a strong, powerful, my way or the highway type of guy. And then when my son was born, you know, it kind of took me, you know, just took over. And then, you know, I'm trying to do everything to support and to love and cherish my wife and to protect her. And then I've got this little kid, and then it doubles with another girl, Daisy, my oldest boy being Sam, and then it triples with my next girl, Ruby, and Lucy, as it does for all of us. And I think the best thing to do is to not, you know, use anything in those kids' life to try to make yourself look better. And I've certainly been, I've certainly done that. And, you know, I feel bad about that. I've yelled at Sam. I've punished him. I've punished my girls, you know, for this and that. I stopped physically punishing my kids. Once Daisy was born, I used to spank Sam. I decided I wasn't going to spank him. Right. I told him I can do push-ups and run.
That's worse. Yeah.
So, you know, that became a really positive thing because I was hitting, you know, I would smack Sam, and then I just told Michelle I'm not going to smack him anymore in the butt because it just, you know, it was just because I was pissed off.
Right.
And so I make him run around the house, or I make him do 10 push-ups, or I make him climb a rope. We got a 30-foot rope. So my three girls grew up that way. And they ran a lot. They did a lot of push-ups.
That's great.
I mean, they just, you know, I hammered them all the time, which I think is wonderful. And they've all come back to me and said, you know, that's been a really good thing.
I got to do that. I didn't even think about doing that. We were trying to pull the timeout stuff. I think I'm going to start making my son do push-ups. You're right. That's okay, a good one.
The best thing I ever did, we'd be at a grocery store and I'd say, Sam, you do that one more time. You talk to your mom one more time like that. You got 25 push-ups.
Right.
I was a snap. But, and then he'd do 25 push-ups right in the store, and I'd have, you know, three mothers that were, you know, clapping, and I'd have two mothers that were saying, you're an asshole.
Really?
But like I told him, I said, better push-ups than me smacking him here. Right. And then, you know, right. I mean, nowadays it'd be on film and I'd
be you'd be arrested. Yeah. Exactly.
And depending on the time of day or the time of week, I'd be a wonderful father or horrible. So, you know, but one of the things that I think I would take back is really trying to just control them. I mean, I was always kind of in this kind of a control mode.
Yeah.
And for the most part, it really worked well. But I also had, you know, I had 1 out of 4, you know, ain't bad, or 3 out of 4 ain't bad, and I got one that is just like me, and she is a son of a bitch. She does not want to listen to anything I say. So me and her, we butt heads, and it's not good. And it's wonderful when we make up, but it's not wonderful when we're butting heads. It's just tough because when you try to control those kids, and most of it's just from being, you know, I want them safe and I want them to listen.
Yeah.
But in hindsight, I think that, you know, I think I'll be a way better grandpa.
Oh, we always that because you learn. You learn the hard way. Now, Andy, let me ask you this question. Obviously, Sam, we've seen him. His physique has gotten better and better every year. He's been competing. He did the collegiate nationals last year. How do you feel about him going into this bodybuilding industry, knowing that you were in the industry, you know all the goods and the bads about it. How do you feel the future of our industry is, and are you comfortable with Sam embracing that and entering it, 100%?
Well, I think it's, it belittles me to even think that I can say that you can't do this. Right. And sometimes I want to, and I probably have told him that. But who am I to say to, let alone anybody from what I've done, let alone my son, and say, you shouldn't do this.
Right.
The problem is, just like you and just like me, just like people that are watching, my son has, he went many, many years not really caring about anything I did. He was going along with it, having fun, embarrassed, whatever.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, what happened? Just like me and you.
Yeah.
He got the bug. And so I'm screwed. It doesn't matter what I say.
That's true. Yeah. He's too old to listen to you anyway.
Your boy, your children right now will listen to everything you say.
Yeah.
And my children listen to nothing. And so I yearn for them to be, not so much in diapers anymore, but, to be toddlers and to be, going through elementary and junior. Because, Sam doesn't really, doesn't concern himself with really what I say now. He certainly respects me. He's always been respectful. He's very intelligent, very nice. He couldn't be a better son. But, I can't tell him, what to do. I can only tell him what I think.
Right.
And so, I love that he's doing it. I love that he's excelling in it. But I also give him some advice to kind of pull back and say, hey, let's take some time. I spent, Dave, just like you, I spent 25 fucking years in the weight room.
Right.
Lifting weights. I don't swear a lot, but I've seen some guys swear on your show, so I thought I'd swear a little.
You could swear, no problem, on this show.
And so I see these guys today, and my son included, and they're like, well, I want to be a pro. I want to be, I want to be 250 pounds. I want to be 300 pounds. I want to be as big as possible. Well, Jesus, you better get in the weight room and spend some time and commit.
Sure.
And when I committed, and I'm sure that this is true for many people, but specifically me, Andy Haman, I committed because I loved to do it. I couldn't wait to do pull-ups. I couldn't wait to do sit-ups. I couldn't wait to ride my bike. I started lifting, and then I lifted nonstop. There was nothing in my mind that told me anything but just to lift.
Right.
And I slowly got stronger and bigger and more muscular and a better physique and leaner, and I started understanding nutrition. And I think now with all the education, that everything is just so fast forward and so it's not easier. I'm not saying it's easier, but think about the information that everybody has now versus, let alone
There's almost there's too much information, Andy, because now with the internet, you don't know what to believe and what not to believe. There's so much, an overwhelming amount of evidence in every direction. I could tell you one thing and you go online and you have someone tell you the complete opposite thing. And so now you don't know who to listen to. So now you have to actually figure out which sources are accurate and which sources are people that are reliable, because there's a lot of phonies and charlatans out there and people trying to sell you snake oil. And they'll tell you whatever they want you to hear so that they can sell you what they got. And so you have to almost be kind of intelligent to be able to weed through the garbage, because, there's so much stuff that's getting in your way. Clutter, I call it, on the internet. You have to get the clutter out of the way so you can actually find, okay, here, this is the information we can listen to. And that's really what RXMuscle was, a beacon in this industry, in this social media internet, bevy of garbage that's out there, that hopefully people say, at least if we watch it on RXMuscle, we know it's true. We don't have to listen to everything they say, but at least when we're listening and when we hear what they're saying, we know that Dave's telling us the truth. And that's always what I've tried to portray with the channel, whether it be through interviews or just informational videos that I provide people with in terms of, educational stuff, debate. I always want people to say, you know, whatever I hear on there, this is the real thing, because a lot of the stuff is not the real thing out there.
Well, that's true. I mean, I've been with you, you know, since the beginning of my career, and that was shortly after you guys started, and RXMuscle has been, and still is today, you know, Muscle in the Morning is kind of a lighthearted, fun look at things, and I love listening to it, and it gives me information. And I think that Dave, you're probably the most influential, you know, informational, most respected person in bodybuilding. And I don't know if you set off to be that way, but you certainly have attained that. And so, I mean, that's something that you should be proud of, and that's something that we're all, you know, glad to have. And, you know, I think that in this day and age, you know, people have to be wary about, you know, the information and things out there. And so maybe I guess it kind of weighs itself out. When I was younger, when we were younger, we didn't have that information. Right. But now there's so much information that people have to, you know, decipher from the bullshit.
Exactly.
And I'm not a bullshitter, and I haven't bullshitted in my work, in my life, but I've never done any sort of thing that would ever hurt anybody or cause harm to somebody. But you're somebody that, and RXMuscle is an organization that we can rely on and that we all love. So
thank you.
You know, I applaud you for that, and I think that I've said that to you over and over, and I continue to say that and promote you as well. And you know, I know people, you know, people are haters, and people, you know, have their fans, and they love this person and they hate this person. But, you know, as you get older, it's pretty easy to just, even if you hate somebody, I mean, let's face it, I get online, you know, I get on social media and I think, you gotta be kidding. What are you talking about? And I just want to say it. And then I go, hey, keep it up. Nice job.
Yeah,
you look huge. It doesn't do me any good. It doesn't do that person any good. You know, we have to stop that. You know, because they're going to come around, and it's going to, you know, it'll kind of fizz out at a certain point. You know, I get people come up to me and talk about Brad Castleberry all the time.
Oh,
and you're bigger. You're stronger. You can kill. You can. I'm like, you know.
Yeah, well, yeah, you're not into that anymore. You don't have anything to prove anymore. Let me ask you this, Andy.
I've met him. I think he's a great guy. He's a promoter. I said, you know, for all I know, you know, he's doing that stuff, and he's a genetic, you know, more so than Brad Castleberry is Michael Hearn. People come up, what do you think of Michael Hearn? I said, let me tell you what, one thing right here. If you would ever, ever meet Michael Hearn, you would never even doubt nothing.
Yeah.
Because he's gigantic. And he's
the way he lifts is incredible. He's crazy strong like you are too.
He's 15 years old. He's continually gotten better.
Yeah.
And so that tells me that he is the real deal.
Yeah. Well, also, I mean, probably the most impressive strong guy out there, or the guy doing the most impressive strength feats, in my mind, no doubt about it, Larry Wheels. This guy's not human, as far as I'm concerned. He's the top.
I don't even know him because I'm fading out. So he's kind of come in as I've faded out.
Just go to his Instagram. Watch his videos. The guy's unbelievable.
I've seen him, and they're insane. And they're insane. But then I go, well, you know, I could maybe shoot.
You would have loved to battle him back in the day, right?
And so I don't know.
Would you have loved to battle him for some of the strength stuff he does back in the day? Because you probably could have done a lot of what he did, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I was doing stuff that none of us knew was the. When I bench pressed 600 pounds, I had no idea it was a big deal. And that's, you know, that's the God's honest truth. I had no idea it was a big deal. Because I didn't even have an internet to even look to see if it was a big deal.
Right.
So the stuff that he's doing is insane. I think I just saw him do a one-arm, you know, deadlift in his hand, you know, and he flew, you know. But, I mean, the stuff that he's doing is insane.
But he does goofy stuff like you do, too. He does fun stuff, too. And if you look at some of the stuff they do, he doesn't take himself that seriously, which I like.
He's a little cuckoo.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's got a hell of a physique and he's super strong.
Well, people said you were cuckoo too. You know that, right?
Yeah, still am.
All right, last question before I let you go. Let's talk about the future of bodybuilding, because we have classic physique, we have men's physique now. It's more of an instantaneous gratification type of event, just like these millennials like. They like to get pro cards fast. They want to be pros. They want to have the pro title under their name. The men's physique in classic seems to fit that bill. You can do it faster. Bodybuilding, harder. We all know that. It takes 10 years to be a great bodybuilder. There's no doubt about that.
Me and you were a little slower. It took us about 30.
Yeah. Is the bodybuilding open division dying? Will it die off because of the fact that people don't want to commit the time anymore? Or will some of the guys that are doing classic and men's physique say, okay, you know what, I've been doing this for 5 years, I'm going to move up to the open now. Even though I got my pro card in this other division, I have a future in the open division. What's your opinion of what's going to happen to bodybuilding 10 years from now?
I think what you're saying, you know, I think that bodybuilding is the nucleus of every young man. And I think if we generally speak about men and young boys getting into lifting weights and weight training, they look at the nucleus. So they're looking at the biggest, baddest, nastiest physiques in the world. And those are bodybuilders.
Right.
And for years, that never changed. That didn't change 10 years ago. It didn't change 20 years ago. It didn't change 30 years ago when I first saw Arnold Schwarzenegger and I saw, Boyer Coe and I saw, Scott Wilson. There's a name for you.
Yeah.
Tom Platzheim. The very first bodybuilder that I ever met ever was Mike Menster. And he was so unbelievable. I couldn't even speak. I was 17 years old. He was the biggest asshole in the world. But my dad was like, why would you ever want to be? And I'm like, I was upset and I cried after I saw him because he wouldn't even take a picture with me. We had a camera. And
oh, really? Wow.
Just $15 or whatever. And we were at this, we didn't have a gym in my hometown. Needless to say, flash forward to a couple months later, I met Tom Platz. Yeah. Well, guess what Tom Platz is? We all know.
Yeah,
Tom Platz
great.
Is probably one of the nicest bodybuilders in the world. Then the third guy that I met was Lee Haney, who's still to this day. I mean, my God, Andy, my guy, you're looking good. Your father loves you. You're the, the God loves you. You're the one, And then years later, he sees my son. He's like, Sam, you're lucky you got your son. That was part of why I, got back and really wanted to be a bodybuilder, because I knew that, I could still be a good person, a good man. But I think what you're talking about is, and what me and you have talked about before, is this really kind of quick, rise to being a pro. And let's face it, if I had that option when I was younger, to be a classic physique, a physique pro, to get to my goal, which I think most guys really want to be a bodybuilder. We have a kid here in town that is just unbelievable. And he got his pro card and he got it like within a year. And his name is Josh Beecham. But Josh Beecham, is a classic physique pro, and he got it like that. Well, he was playing football for a high school team here, and he entered a couple of local shows. He went regional, he went national. Boom, he won. He got his pro card within a year. Well, he deserves to. I mean, he in that class. But I truly believe that Josh wants to be a bodybuilder.
Right.
I mean,
but will there be bodybuilding? Will bodybuilding have the talent pool that it's had in the past with all the classic physique guys now that are kind of staying in classic because they think that there's more acceptance, online? It seems like social media favors classic now as being the way to go,
Well, I think that if we talk about the masses, and what really what people want to look like, that's the look. People want to have a thinner, they want to have thinner legs, they want to have a more classic look, they want to have a taller, leaner look. Whether you're short or medium or tall, you still want to have a little bit less leg, bigger upper body. You know, Arnold was like that. Arnold, you know, at his biggest, still didn't have anything close to what's going on in the pro bodybuilding leg category. But as soon as you start getting legs, you know, it just, it pulls you down an inch or two or three, and you just start looking like, you know, the Hulk, which.
That's what I wanted to look like. I wanted to be the Hulk, you know, that was my goal.
That's what we wanted. But I wanted to be a 6 foot Hulk.
Yeah, me too.
You know, which is tough. And so, you know, it's kind of this tug of war between, you know, well, okay, do I want to be popular? Do I want to make money? And I talked to my son, Sam. I said, listen, Sam, I said, the popularity is in the classic physique. People want to look like you. You already have attained a look that most men want.
Right.
But he doesn't, you know, he and a million other guys, they want to get bigger. Mm. And it's like, you don't need to get bigger. You're already there. Just get thicker and get more quality muscle. Keep your abs. Get thicker. Keep your wide shoulders. Keep your waist and your glutes. You know, and look at 15 years ago, 20 years ago, no such thing as a superhero movie. Now every other month there's a superhero movie.
Sure, yeah.
It was a dream, and that was your dream back then.
Yeah, absolutely.
We never would have predicted that.
No.
And it's the same thing, I think, with classic physique. I think that it's a wonderful thing, but I think we all have to understand that, you know, give everybody their props. You know, bodybuilding does take, you know, a minimum of 10 to 15 years.
Will guys do that, though? Will they wait that long and do open bodybuilding? Will there be an open bodybuilding division with quality that we've seen in the past, or will it diminish and become kind of like a sideshow to classic bodybuilding?
Well, I hope it doesn't become like the female bodybuilders, where eventually they get pushed out and the men get pushed out.
What's your insight on that? I mean, what do you think?
I mean, my insight is that it will never happen, because men, young men and young boys, young men, and men always look to that extreme. Hmm. And so I think that that's going to always happen. I want to have the fastest, biggest motherfucking car in the world. I want to have the biggest motherfucking house in the world. I want to be the strongest guy in the world. Strong man, huge houses, super fast cars. Yeah. I want to be the biggest mother mofo. I want a bodybuilder. I don't think it's ever going to happen.
All right. Well, only time will tell. We'll have this conversation in another 5 and 10 years, and we'll see if your prediction and my predictions are right, and we'll see what happens.
Dave.
Yeah. You'll still be flexing, though. Let me see. You got abs?
Yeah. I got abs.
Let me see.
Yeah. I'll show you a picture online.
Don't just go in the back room and spray paint them on.
I have never not had it.
I know. You always have abs. That's why I always ask you.
Yeah.
Andy, thank you so much for all you give back to the industry. You're one of the really good guys. I think that if anyone ever needs advice, I think that you're the guy to go to. You have a lot of wisdom to impart. You're a teacher, but yet you're kind, and I know you do a lot of generosity type things.
We didn't even talk about my charity work. It doesn't need to be talked to, but let me just say this. Thank you, Dave Palumbo, for being who you are, how many people you help, and for being the intelligent man that you are, and we'll see you guys later. And one other thing, if you ever meet me, you'll never hate me.
Andy turned the interview around on me, and he ended the interview as if he's interviewing me. So on that note, I'm Dave Palumbo with Andy Haman for another installment of Live With. Catch you next time, guys.
RX Muscle rocks.